Last week I like launched myself at you.
Thank you. Welcome to worship with Augusta Heights Baptist Church on a rainy, gross morning, but glad that you ventured out and braved the weather to be here, or those that didn't quite venture out but maybe watching with us online. Welcome to all of you, however you are worshiping with us on this second Sunday of Advent. If you are a visitor with us, especially if this is one of your first times with us, I would encourage you to fill out a visitor's card. Those are in the pockets in the pews in front of you. You can fill that out, drop it in one of these white boxes up here, these offering boxes where offerings can also go. And there's one at the back in the vestibule as well. You can just do that on your way out. Or if you're watching online, leave a comment so we know who you are. And if we can be of service or support in any way, please don't hesitate to reach out to us. And we are so glad that you are here. I do hope that you will come back and join us throughout this Advent and Christmas season. In your bulletin, there is a list of some of our special services that are coming up, and I'll call your attention to the longest night service. This is a service that we do on the longest night of the year, when the darkness is the longest that it will be. And it's a way for us to hold space in the context of worship for the not-so-positive emotions that often come with these holiday times. It's not all joy and carols for all of us. And so this is a way for us to hold that space, to offer our expressions of grief, of sorrow, of frustration, of pain, even as we look for some sense of hope, some sense of peace in this holiday season. So if that is something that you are needing, or you have a friend or a loved one, a family member who that might be meaningful for, we encourage you to be here for that service. Also, if you are newer to the church, if you're visiting or if you're a newer member and want to know more, you'll see in there that we are going to be starting Why We Are the Way We Are, which goes by the acronym WOWOATAWOWA. We're working on that. But that will be Sundays at 9:30 a.m. starting in January for about 6 weeks. This is a chance to learn more about the church, about who we are, about what we do, and also to meet some other newcomers to the church as well. There's no RSVP required. You can just show up, but we'll be covering something a little different each week, so make a plan to be there, and if you have any questions, just let us know. I see many of you brought in your angel tree gifts already, those that were due today. I know all of our angels have been taken, so just a reminder, if you took one of those, to get those back in to us. I believe next Sunday is the last day to bring those in, so just a friendly reminder to do that. I'll also call your attention to the prayer concerns and celebrations that are printed in your bulletin. And I will add one to those, unfortunately, asking that you pray for Mary Alice Pinkley and her family. Her son, Stuart, who lives in New York City, who was with us in worship just about a month ago when he was visiting her down here, passed away. He had been in ICU for 3 weeks, and his heart just gave out. His body could no longer sustain it. So please keep Mary Alice in your prayers. Also, her other son, Bo, who is grew up at the church, a member here, please keep them in your prayers, especially during this holiday time. I also will remind you, again, not printed in your bulletin, but on the front row here, we have some of our Advent devotionals available for you. These are have been compiled by our associate pastor, Eric Beber. Many of you have written for them. They're written by our own church members. So we have printed copies of those available, or if you'd like to get on the church's email list, we're emailing those out every day throughout this season of Advent as well. So just let the church office know and we can get you signed up for that. Thank you again for worshiping with us on this Sunday of peace as we come seeking God's peace and presence even when our lives are hard and in this troubling world. So I want to invite up the Brown family, who will be leading us in lighting the candle of peace. Let us worship together.
Got it How does a weary world practice peace?
By listening before we speak and saying sorry when we need to. By advocating for justice and caring for our neighbor.
By practicing Sabbath and forgiving 70 times 7. By choosing grace over hate and opening the door for each other.
There are a million ways to practice peace.
So today we light the candle of peace as a reminder and a charge.
With God's help, may we bring peace to a weary world. Please pray with me. Dear Lord, we have heard that this is the Sunday of peace, but some of us may not feel at peace. We are searching and seeking for something to calm our spirits and give us rest. Whether it's the busyness of the season or life events beyond our control, we are desperate for the peace we have read about in your scriptures. Lord, being in your presence, hearing your word, and singing your songs is an opportunity for us to receive your peace. Allow that to wash over us like the rain this morning so that we can carry your peace with us from this place and into the world. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
And I invite you to stand and let's all sing together our opening hymn. It's number 76, O Come, Emmanuel.
Thank you.
seated, and we'll invite children to come forward for the children's message with Mr. Pete.
Hey, everybody. I'll give everybody a few seconds to get up here. All right, how are we all doing?
Good.
That didn't sound very enthusiastic. How are you all doing?
Good.
I like that. Well, I'm going to talk to you today about something. I know that we're past Halloween and we're almost to Christmas, but I want to talk to you about something that scares Mr. Pete. What do you think might scare Mr. Pete? What do you think, Madeline?
Spiders.
Spiders do scare Mr. Pete, but that's not what I'm talking about. Lennon, what do you think? That's actually right. The dark scares Mr. Pete. Do you want to see it scare me? Because I don't know if you noticed, but EJ walked over there, and I think he might do something. Do you want him to scare Mr. Pete?
Yeah!
EJ, I guess you can go. Ah! Oh my gosh. What happened?
The lights went out.
Oh, I don't know if you noticed, but Mr. Pete was very scared. Why do you think Mr. Pete would be scared of the dark?
Because those shadows.
The shadows, yeah. There could be shadows lurking about. What? What?
I thought it was something that's gonna come back.
And it was
yeah, my brain's tricking me. I might not see what. I might not be able to see what's moving around. Yeah, let's do one more.
Because
I don't have any lights. Yeah, when it's dark outside or when it's dark inside, I'm not able to see what's around me, right? I don't know if it's good or it's bad. And if I try to move around, I might bump into things and hurt myself, right? Because I can't see where I'm going. So whenever it's dark, do you know what Mr. Pete likes to use?
Flashlight.
Actually, when it's nighttime, Mr. Pete carries this around. Oops. What's this?
A nightlight.
A nightlight. Yes, Mr. Pete cannot sleep without a nightlight. Why do you think a nightlight is so good when it's dark? Yeah, because it lights up. Yeah, what do you think, Lennon?
It lights up the night.
It lights up the night, but how do you think it can help me overcome my fear of the dark? Yeah, Madeline.
The light covers up the darkness.
The light covers up the darkness, yes. Let's do one more. The light holds up the darkness, yeah. But is Mr. Pete, if I have this nightlight on and it covers up the darkness, am I able to see if there's good or bad things around me?
Yeah.
And if I'm trying to walk somewhere, will it guide me and I'll be able to see where I'm supposed to go?
Yeah.
Yeah, which is good, right? Well, what we're going to hear about today is, did you know way back a long time ago, God was kind of like the dark to people. Do you know how? They weren't sure, they couldn't see him, and they weren't sure if he was good or he was bad. But guess what? God sent them down a nightlight, and he sent us a nightlight. What do you think that nightlight was? Yeah, Jack. Jesus, yes! God sent us Jesus. How do you think Jesus acted like a nightlight for us? What did he do? Yeah. The star and the moon act like a nightlight? That's 100% true. Yeah, God gave us the stars and the moons too. Yeah.
But Jesus, like a nightlight, he lighted up all the dark.
Yeah, he lighted up the dark. He showed us where to go and how to act. And he showed us that God was good. Even if we couldn't necessarily see God, he told us that it was good, right? He was like our nightlight, right?
Yeah.
Awesome. So whenever you guys are feeling dark inside or scared, I want you guys to think of Jesus and remember him as your nightlight, okay? Showing us what we need to do and showing us that God is good. All right? All right. Will you guys pray with me? All right. Dear God, thank you for sending Jesus down as our nightlight to light up the darkness and lead us to good things. And we just thank you so much for giving us your son. Amen. Thank you, guys. I was a scaredy cat. That's true.
y'all thought I was going to sing. I can only imagine your relief. Okay. Scripture for today is chapter 40, Isaiah, verses 1 through 5. Comfort, O comfort the people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain shall be, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. This be the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Together in prayer. Oh, gracious and loving God, we come here this morning bringing with us all of our gratitude and all that gives us life and all that brings us joy and every anticipation and hope, all that we carry, and as well, all that keeps us up at night. We come to this space with reminders of division and injustice and violence in our world. Reports of wars in our news feeds demand our attention, attention which is usurped only by the news of yet another war. And even in places where there is no fighting, where affordable housing is lacking, or where children feel neglected, or where women navigate an abusive relationship to stay housed, or where people turn to narcotics to numb their life's pain, or where someone feels like all hope is lost, we, oh God, need your peace. Not a Pax Romana sort of peace, where the powerful silence the weak, but we seek a peace that brings the mountains low and fills every valley. We seek a peace that, as Dr. King imagined, is not merely the absence of war, but the presence of justice. We seek a peace, as St. Paul described, which surpasses all understanding, which will guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. And so we pray this morning, God, for those who are displaced by fighting, that they may find shelter from the bombs. We pray for those needing housing for their family, that they would find keys to a safe home, and that we would seek solutions to our nation's housing crisis. We pray that all children would know how deeply they are loved by you and by us. We pray that all women in Greenville County would live safely in their own home without the threat of abuse. We pray for community and connection for all those navigating substance abuse in AA and NA. We pray that all who feel hopeless can rest in the truth that we are loved by you, beautifully and wonderfully made, O God. We hear the prophet Isaiah this morning promising comfort, O comfort your people. And as we find our own comfort in you, God, we ask that you would guide us to be extensions of your comfort, that we would be designers of peace, builders of justice, producers of kindness, as partners, as co-creators with you, God. May our lives point to the Christ who comes in love and compassion, who was born into a chaotic world that seeks a peace that passes all understanding. All these things we pray in the name of the Prince of Peace, Jesus our Savior. Amen. I invite you now to stand and sing with us hymn number 93, It Came Upon Midnight.
Touch their own.
Thank you. You may be seated.
Our New Testament lesson this morning comes to us from the book of Luke, chapter 1, verses 26 through 38. Hear these words. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee, which was called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord be with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be good. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be true, since I'm a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you. The Holy Spirit will come and bring power to the Most on High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called the Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who will be said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be so with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
A little over 50 years ago, James Carroll, a Catholic priest, sat in a Washington, D.C. jail cell. He and fellow clergy and others, about two dozen of them in all, had sat down in the rotunda of the Capitol building to demand that Congress put an end to the war in Vietnam. Their protest, however, had very little effect, and they'd been arrested and were now spending the night in a dark, cold jail. Carroll was dejected and depressed. He was afraid. He was feeling very alone in this eerily quiet cell. Each of their cramped spaces separated by a steel wall from the adjoining cell, each one in their own room. He was feeling disheartened, discouraged, alone, until the prisoner in the cell next to him began to sing. He had no idea what prompted him to start singing, and it began softly at first. Until this resolute baritone began to fill the air with what he recognized as Handel's Messiah.
"Come for thee, my people."
Carroll recognized the voice. It was that of William Sloan Coffin, the leader of their group. And the young priest said he sang as if he were alone on earth. And the old words rose through the darkness as if Isaiah himself had returned to speak for you to God. To speak for God to you. Coffin kept going as other voices who knew it started to join in.
"Every valley shall be exalted, and every mountain and hill made low. the crooked street,
the rough places of plain. His singing in the depths of that jail performed a small miracle that night. It lifted the spirits of his fellow prisoners, and those who recounted it said it did give them a sense of peace, reminding them that even in their solitary cells, they were not alone. That they were there because they were following in God's way and that God was there with them too. Or as one of the fellow prisoners, an atheist activist, later wrote, "For a moment, you believed in God, if only because William Sloan Coffin did." Today is the second Sunday of Advent, traditionally the Sunday of peace, which I have to admit is next to impossible to preach on because it's such a loaded word. We have so many associations with it. World peace, rest in peace, the Nobel Peace Prize. You may call to mind a calm, meditative state, a tranquil landscape laid out before you. Maybe a Sunday afternoon nap as the rain comes down. Maybe the bed that you wish you were in right now. Or those of you watching online, maybe that you are in right now. Or, like many of you, I'm sure, you may think of the 1991 Augusta Circle Elementary School third grade performance, that historic event in which my classmates and I led a rousing rendition of our school song, "This School Is My School, This School Is Your School." Go Eagles. And we closed that performance holding hands and swaying back and forth and singing, "Let there be peace on earth. And let it begin with me." Not a dry eye in the house. And yet peace, at least the way the Bible speaks of it, can't be compared to a bunch of 8-year-olds swaying and singing. It's not beauty pageant answers about an end to world conflict. God's peace, described by prophets like Isaiah, usually using that Hebrew word shalom, is not the absence of noise or activity or disturbance or tension or conflict. It's not an absence at all. It is a presence. As Eric mentioned in his prayer, the presence of justice, of love, of compassion, of reconciliation, the presence of God's purposes being played out. When human beings have well-being, when we are in right relationship with God and with each other, when, in the words of St. Julian of Norwich, all shall be well, and all shall be well, and all manner of thing shall be well. Or in the words of St. Matthew of McConaughey, when everything is all right, all right, all right. For all of God's children. And for all of creation, too. But that kind of peace doesn't just happen. We don't just sit around and wait on a peaceful, easy feeling to wash over us, hoping that God's shalom will happen somehow, some way, someday. Because this peace is not just something we wait for, it's something we work for. The prophet is directed to comfort the people, promising that God will make a way to be with them, but valleys raised up and mountains raised, rough places graded smooth and crooked roads rerouted and straightened out, that's not comfort, y'all. That's construction. And a worksite with heavy equipment is not an image that comes to mind when I think of peace. And yet if peace means God's purposes realized, then it might take some work. It might even take some discomfort. Because there can be no peace without justice, without the makings of that abundant life for all, without mountains of inequity brought down to ground level to level out the playing field, without valleys of deep poverty and need filled in with resources, raising people up not by their own bootstraps, but by others' generosity and opportunity. Without the rough and rocky ground of systemic racism made plain through the work of education and reflection and proximity and conversation and conversion. Without the crooked ways of corruption and exploitation and abuses of power finally straightened out by transparency and accountability. And that's not still quiet or comfortable, especially not for those of us who already live fairly comfortable lives. Then again, the goal is not for me or us, however we define us, to be comfortable. God's goal is for all people to know God's comfort and peace. In the words of the prophet, that all flesh would see God's glory and goodness and grace. It's a glory and a grace that we see embodied in the baby Mary will birth, as told to her by the angel Gabriel in our gospel passage this morning. And yet even Mary herself is no picture of passivity or peace, as we often think of it. Sure, we like to paint her in softer hues, hair combed and head covered, poised in prayerful surrender. Artwork often shows her meek and mild, bowed down in deference before Gabriel, or maybe with face and palms upturned, almost as if to say, okay, whatever. But Mary didn't have comfort or ease in her life. She was a poor, unwed teenager, living in a powerful and violent empire, as an oppressed ethnic and religious minority. And yet even so, she is bold and brave and fiercely faithful, willing to say yes to the creative work of God when it is presented to her. Mary accepts this dangerous charge because, let's be honest, every birth was dangerous in those days. Even though the world around her is turbulent, even though she has no standing or status in that world, even though so much is unknown about exactly what God is doing or how, still she actively chooses to say yes, in spite of the fact that her world is chaotic, her life is uncertain, and her future is unknown. Or maybe she says yes because of that. The gospel writer tells us that Mary was perplexed by Gabriel's words. Some translations read greatly troubled. The Greek word literally means stirred up. At the angel's announcement, something is stirred up within her. What she thought was fixed and unchangeable has somehow been shaken loose by these impossible possibilities the angel is pronouncing to her. Her life has been unsettled, and because she says yes, God is able to do something new through her child. Through that child, God will stir up the world where the first will be last, where outcasts and strangers will become friends and family, where love will become more powerful than fear and hate and even death, where God's peace will be embodied and realized more fully than it ever had been before. So maybe Mary's example can prompt us to ask ourselves, when the mystery of God's love breaks through into our lives, will I reject it because I don't understand it? Will I turn away from it or deny it or close myself off to it because it is confusing or unsettling or uncomfortable? Or in the words of Kathleen Norris, am I virgin enough to respond and say, yes, let it be. A yes that will change me forever. Now, you probably won't be asked to birth a baby, and certainly not the one who will embody God's hope and peace and joy and love for the world. But you will be asked, you are being asked, in whatever way you can, to embody hope and peace and joy and love, bringing it into the world, born out through your life. Because it is by saying yes to God, by walking in the way of the Lord, even with the smallest of steps, that we create that highway for our God that Isaiah imagined, a path by which God's presence and promises and purposes, God's peace, can come into our world and into our lives. Pastor and author Richard Lisher remembers pastoring his very first church in a small rural farming town, a community that was, in his words, as tightly sealed as a jar of home canned pickles. He met an aerial photographer one time who remarked that from the air, you could see all these well-worn paths crisscrossing the pastures and the fields that surrounded these folks' homes. And at first, that photographer thought that they had been created by animals, cows and sheep walking back and forth. But then he realized that they went from door to door. These paths were the product of neighbors walking to visit each other, to care for each other, to check on each other in times of need. As Lisher wrote, these are the highways of God, grooved into human relationships. The highways of God trod into the very landscape by Christian love. Paths formed by caring and serving and healing and loving, ways made by walking in God's way. Gradually, slowly, daily, a little bit at a time, over a very long time. We make the way by walking. It's actually the title of a great song by one of my favorite guitarists, acoustic singers, David Wilcox. He's originally from Asheville. He actually won an award for this song a number of years ago. And the chorus goes, we make the way by walking. We make the way by walking. Humor me for a second. Can y'all sing that? We make the way by walking. We make the way by walking. I climbed a little bit higher. Some things you can't unsee. I walked a little bit further and the walking set me free. Then you were walking with me and you asked if I knew the way. I made you laugh when I said our path might be a road someday. Might be a road someday. We make the way by walking. We make the way by walking. We make the way by walking. Our steps are the votes we cast. The crazy few that have seen this view may not be the last. The way that a pilgrim travels is to set out for parts unknown. So if history's kind, we're the ones who may find the way we all come home. We make the way by walking. We make the way by walking. Nice job. We make the way through which God's presence and purposes enter our world by walking in the way of the Lord. Every day, little by little, as we wear into the landscape of our lives paths of peace and justice and mercy and compassion and love. And no matter what may come, as the angel Gabriel told Mary, God is with us. No matter who we are, no matter what we've done or haven't done, despite how difficult it might be for us to believe it, our lives are already pregnant with divine promise. But it is our choice whether or not we will say yes to that promise, to what God is doing in us and what God can do through us. Doesn't mean that it won't be unsettling or inconvenient or uncertain or confusing or uncomfortable. Mary says yes to God without fully knowing what her participation in God's work will entail or where it will lead her. Well, not exactly, because she doesn't actually say yes. Mother Mary says, let it be. Which sounds passive, right? It sounds almost apathetic. Grammatically, it sounds like it should be in passive voice, but I did some research, meaning that I consulted with my former English teacher mother-in-law, and let it be is in fact active. It just has an understood subject. You. Friends, all God is asking of us is for each of us, for you, to say with Mary, yes, let it be. To say yes to love, to our love for God and for others, and let it be grace that guides our relationships. To say yes to the needs of others and let it be service that defines our lives. To say yes to justice and mercy and let it be compassion and equity that governs our world. To say yes to God's peace coming to this earth and let it begin with me, with us, in us and through us. Yes. Let it be. Amen.
Thank you.
is our prayer. So let us stand and sing together our closing hymn, O Little Town of Bethlehem, as we await for God to abide with us and even to be born in us. Let's stand and sing together, number 86, O Little Town of Bethlehem. Go and let it be us through whom God is at work in the world. And as we go, we pray that God would give us grace never to sell ourselves short, grace to risk something big for something good, grace to remember that the world is too dangerous for anything but truth and too small for anything but love. So may God take our minds and think through them. May God take our lips and speak through them. May God take our hands and work through them. And may God take our hearts and set them on fire this day, every day, and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace.